Aloha, everyone, and mahalo and welcome. I'm on fire today. I've never been on fire like this before in my life. And all day long, I have absolutely been on this stream of consciousness fire. And this is the end of the day, and I'm still on fire. And I haven't wilted too much yet, but I've got to, temper it down a little bit until I see, is it too fiery or not? But wow. Yesterday I said, okay, Guru Yoga, I'm in. I said, Longchenpa, I'm in. Well, what do you think happened? I'll tell you exactly what happened. Last night in a dream, fantastic meeting with Longchenpa. Very brief, very to the point, very effective. And it took me a little while to get over the shock of it today. And so I was like, what should I do? What should I do? And gradually I'm catching fire. So I'm a catching fire. Yeah, I'm a cheerleader for his side, the side of truth, the side of truth. And I had a tremendous breakthrough today, which basically said that all our efforts to wake up are actually defenses. I saw it. Because it's implying we're asleep. What a trick. What an amazing trick we've been playing on ourselves. We're not asleep. None of us have ever fallen asleep. That's a lie. We never fell asleep. To say that we fell asleep is the lie. And we're inferring, well, we must have fallen asleep because we're trying so hard to wake ourselves up. And we can't seem to wake ourselves up. But that's because we never fell asleep. But by all these defenses and efforts in the world that are trying to, we try to wake ourselves up. Oh, we're asleep. We need to wake up. This is all part of the defensive system that's inferring, trying to convince ourselves that we must have fallen asleep. And that's the whole trick. Because as long as we keep thinking we've fallen asleep, this is the trouble. We haven't fallen asleep, actually. So you don't really awaken. You just realize you never fell asleep. Amazing, amazing breakthrough. And this caught me by surprise. I just said, wow. Okay, so I'm just letting that wow, okay? Just let it wow. Just let it wow. Just wow this, as we always do. Just wow it. When you get a reaction, you say, I'm not sure how to react. Well, just wow it. Then you say, oh, that feels good. Just wow it. So I'm a cheerleader. I'm going to get pom-poms, actually, probably. I'm a big-time cheerleader for Coach Longchenpa, as I call him now. Coach Longchenpa is on the sidelines, folks, and I mean this literally, okay? I had this dream, and he's just walking. I was going like into this gym. There's all these people outside the gym, warming up. The yoga girls and the yoga guys, and all these different types are all doing these exercises and practices, and they're all warming up. And I said, hey, I think I want to go in the gym. So I went into the foyer. Like sometimes there's a gym, there's the outer door, and there's the lobby, and then there's the inner door to go into the gym, like a basketball court. Okay, so I went into the outer door into the lobby area. And then this door opens from outside, and in walks this guy. He's like a young man, in the prime of life, though. He's like 28, 30 or something. He's dressed in slacks and a business shirt, a button, long sleeve buttoned business shirt, open at the collar, no tie or sports coat. Something like that. He's dressed like this. And he's just briskly walking through the lobby, just sort of smoothly striding through like he owns the place, very confident, super confident and smooth. Not arrogant, just super confident and relaxed, this relaxed, smooth, super confidence. He's just walking through. And he's walking right, but he's going to walk right past me. And he greets me. He goes, hi, Ross. Like that, just real enthusiastic, positive, but also smooth and calm. And smiling, his face is just really calm and smooth, but smiling, and his eyes are just radiating super confidence. And I was like, huh? Do I know you? He goes, yeah, you're us. And then he just keeps on going and walks into the gym. So he hailed me by name as if he knew me extremely well. He's like really happy to see me. Someone's is on his team. So I go into the gym, and I see him, and he goes up to the right sideline, like a basketball court. I'm like one of the ends of the basket, where the basket would be, and there's a right sideline and a left sideline, right, where the coaching staff's on. There's benches, and there's coaching staffs on either side, and he goes to the right sideline, and he's the coach. And there's other assistant coaches. It's a coaching staff. He's part of this coaching staff, let's say. And they're collaborating. They're talking like this. And I sit down at the end against the wall there at the end of this court, and I just looking around, and there's nobody else inside. Just the coaching staffs and me. That's it. And then I just start to cry. I'm disconsolate. I said, I don't know why. I just felt so overwhelmed that there's this. I'm there's nobody else in here. It just seemed to struck me so strongly. And then so I woke up in the morning kind of depressed. But at some point in the day, I rallied myself and just said, hey, I'm here to help bring super confidence to the world. That is my goal. So I don't care about anything else. I'm just going to do the best I can. I'm just going to bring it. I don't care if there's nobody else here or not. I'm going to do my job. Okay? So I snapped out of it. And then suddenly, I just start going on fire today with super confidence and absolutely just super humor and bubbling, just effervescent bubbling and just incisive and incisive, just amazing. I was like a cheerleader. And I realized I'm a cheerleader for the side of truth, okay? I'm a cheerleader for truth. The truth is we never fell asleep. We never even started dreaming, actually. Jesus said that everything was over in an instant. But all of this stuff we're trying to do, positivity stuff, that's the trick. That's how we're deceiving ourselves into thinking, well, I'm doing good stuff. I'm trying to be enlightened. I'm working on the path. This is what Longchenpa talks about, the graduated path. This is what he's getting to. This is what Radical Dzogchen is getting to, actually. Is all these efforts to awaken actually are deceiving us into thinking we fell asleep. We never fell asleep. Okay, now this is something that just dawned on me today. So, just hear it and just say, wow, just wow it. Just wow it. You don't have to agree with it. You don't have to disagree with it. Your heart might be kind of beating a little faster. Say, wow. And mine certainly did and certainly has been all day. This set me on fire, this insight. Most, advocative day ever. I mean, I'm just turned into this cheerleader, which is great. Cheerleader for the side of truth. Now, there's plenty of cheerleaders over there who are telling us, well, yeah, we're cheerleaders for death. Actually, I'm a cheerleader for eternal life. There's plenty over there cheerleaders for death. And I found out something really, really amazing today. How we get tricked. And what they basically say was, well, I'm only asking to die just one time, and we're all dying, so why don't you die with us? That'll make us all feel better, because if you don't die, that makes us feel bad. I died, but I didn't have to die. But if you die, we'll say, well, we all have to die, but it's only one death, and that's it. We're not asking much. They say, hey, wait a minute, I've died 32 times already in this world, and every single freaking time, it's exactly the same trick. We're only asking to die once. I said, no, you've asked me to die 32 times. Now you're trying to ask me to die the 33rd time. It says you're out of luck. Because Coach Longchenpa is in the house. You're out of luck this time. Your luck has run out. Your little trick bag doesn't work anymore. So Coach is on the sideline now. The coach is on the sideline. It was Longchenpa that walked through that lobby. He had this buzz cut. Buzz cut type. It wasn't a buzz cut. It was a, what do you call it? Yeah, buzz cut. It was all the way around, but real short. Like the hair was like about, 3/8 of an inch long or something like that, all the way around. It was dark black, and he looked like a Tibetan. He looked like a Tibetan monk, except he was wearing Western business clothes. Or, Western dress casual, like a coach would wear, except but he wasn't wearing a sports coat. And he was just... This is somebody who knew his business. It was all business, and he knows his business. He's there to coach this situation here. Okay. He's like a coach, like a basketball coach, for instance. like Steve Kerr. Steve Kerr knows his business for the Golden State Warriors. He really knows his business. He is really, really good at saying the right thing at the right time. Okay. Coach Longchenpa is this awesome coach. And the game is being played right now is the game to get you to die one more time. Well, just die this once. You know, I say, just die just this once. Just do this little old thing for me. Can you just die this once for me? And I say, that's exactly the same thing you said to me for 32 lifetimes. Okay. And one of the biggest lies, you see, in order to perpetrate this atrocity, just is they say, no, there's no such thing as reincarnation. What are you talking about? You're crazy. This is their atrocious lie, okay, which they have to say that in order to say, well, you're only going to die one time, so what's the big deal? I mean, you could do that little favor for little old me, can't you? So this is, for me, I say, recognizing reincarnation as a fact was the most important step that ever happened to me, and it was spontaneous. I suddenly spontaneously remembered all my lives. I was just, that just, wow. This changed my entire life. I realized, wow, they've run the same scam on me every single time. The ego tricks me. It's been tricking me for 32 lives. Just watch this death movie just one time. Suppressing a sneeze. Phew. Gone. Almost. And as soon as I realized, oh my gosh, they do this. What they're really asking you to do is just keep on dying forever. That's really what they're asking you to do. Just do me a little old favor and just die forever, won't you? And I said, just do me this one little favor. Just accept that I'm not going to die right this lifetime, okay? Maybe some other one I will, but not this lifetime. Just this one little favor, just one time. Out of all these 33rd life now, just do me one little time and don't expect me to grant you that favor this time. How about that? Oh, well, you know. Coach Longchenpa's in the house. Coach Longchenpa's in the house. Coach Longchenpa's in the house. And this is a fact. How quick does he answer prayers? Well, the very next night when I decide, yeah, okay, I'll do this. Boom. He's there. Hi, Ross. Like we're on totally familiar terms. I'm part of his team. He greeted me like I was part of his team. So, coach me up, coach. Absolutely, coach me up. So those of you who are waiting for Coach Longchenpa, let me tell you for sure, coach is in the house. Coach is in the house. So get your pom-poms, okay? Get your pom-poms. Get your pom-pom on. Because we're going to be cheerleading. We're going to be cheerleading. I was singing today, too. Singing pretty good again. It started out, my voice was terrible. I'm so tired. I've been working out. I'm achy and exhausted, but my body, my muscles, holy cow. I'm a wreck, but it's good. As I talked to my buddy, he said, you know what? When it aches, it's good. That means you really worked out. But then I said, well, I better start hitting the protein. And I did today. I did today. I absolutely really did. And I started feeling better. And suddenly my voice, I caught this confidence. I snapped out of this kind of feeling, woe is me, you know, where's all my support, you know. I said, well, you know what? That's not my problem. I'm going to do my job because I love doing it. That's what I came to do. I'm going to do what I came to do here. And let all the dominoes, let everything fall as they may, right? That's not my problem. I snapped out of it and then started singing. I started singing way, way better. And wow, started popping it more. I said, holy cow. And I suddenly got this super confidence bug. And I want everybody to catch this super confidence bug. You know, it's contagious. You know, catch the super confidence bug. It's the best bug you'll ever catch, actually. this is my role, is to help you catch that super confidence bug. And when you get it, you'll know you got it. And I said before that when you meet with Longchenpa, he transmits something to you. You catch something from him. First time, well, the first time I saw him, I was kind of like, whoa, you know, what is the, can I don't know. Wow. This is amazing. Then the second time, I caught this inherent spaciousness vision bug. I really did. This time, well, and then the next time, I caught the singing bug. And then this time, I caught this super confidence bug from him. So, he's a real buggy guy. He's got the good bugs to catch. I mean, you want to be around here. You want him to cough on you. Believe me. Hey, Longchenpa, cough on us all, won't you? We're going to go on the coughing tour. You know, not the coffin tour. That's the other side. They're going on the coffin tour. Say, to everybody, you know, it's really cool to get in the coffin. You know, you can end your life by getting in the coffin. Isn't that cool? Just, you know, do it once and see what it's like. That's the coffin tour. We're doing the coughing tour where Longchenpa is going to cough on you. and you're gonna catch the super bug, which is the bug of super positivity, super confidence, absolutely. And I tell you, it's great. I haven't been tired the last 2 days. It's amazing. I'm not getting hardly any sleep. It's getting disrupted severely. I'm drinking these kale smoothies at night with this vegan protein powder. I don't know if that's helping. Something's helping. Maybe it's just I'm getting my confidence back, you know, super confidence back, which is what I came into this world. I wanted to bring super confidence in the world. Everybody's scared the heck out of everybody. You said, wow, you know, where does that come from? I don't know. That's interfering with my plans for death. You know, we can't do that. God would be mad at us if we don't die. Of course, Jesus said God didn't create death, but somehow they got lost in translation from going into the years to, you know, something or was kicking around in there where it just doesn't quite sink in yet. You know, it's floating on the surface. God created us not as body, but as truth and life, eternal life and truth. God doesn't create form bodies. He created us truth and life, spirit and life. I mean, a lot of what Jesus said, somehow it's still floating on the surface. Hasn't sunk in yet. Got to put some heavy weights on that and pull it down into the core of our being. If you know Jesus, you know Longchenpa. If you know Longchenpa, you know Jesus. This is a fact. That's an absolute fact. Because they both know the same truth, which is reality. And reality is unchanging. It's the same for everyone. In fact, we never left reality. We never even fell asleep. This is really crucial. Just hear this and just say, hmm. Don't think it. Don't start thinking, just let your heartbeat, your pulse go faster. Just like, oh my gosh. Just don't even say anything. Just be aware of your reaction. Your reaction will tell you how profound it is. Your reaction will tell you, not the words. Forget about the words. Be super positive beyond words. Super positive beyond words. In terms of trying to conceptually understand anything. I'm emoting. I'm sparkling like a sparkler. Getting ready for the 4th of July here. But that's a different story. I'm a cheerleader. It's a different story. I'm not trying to conceptualize how I feel. If I was, I wouldn't be super positive, super confident, right? So the other side is just positive, the positives. And what are they doing? Say, it's dying is a very positive thing. It's very dignified. And you're really going to feel like you've lived, had a life well lived if you end up in a coffin. You know, that everybody ends up in a coffin, the high, the low, and everybody's equalized by tasting the grave. We're all one in our, you know, in our death. It's the great leveler. We all want to be leveled down to the lowest common denominator, don't we? Death. We all be leveled down to death. that's what the positives are cheering for, you know. But the super positives, you know, wow. We're saying, hey, eternal life, you are eternal, we are eternal life right now. We've never stopped being eternal life, okay? We never fell asleep. We never started dreaming, actually, at all. Just let that sink in. Don't think about it. That's death. You start thinking about it, that's death. You're back in positivity. This is super positivity. Super positivity just wows it. They don't have to conceptualize it, just wow it. That's the path of super positivity. So Coach Longchenpa was just greeting me. He said, one of my players has showed up. One of my cheerleaders showed up. Great, hi Ross. Yeah, like that. And he's like, he knew. He said, I know you're going to show up. I already know. You already. So you showed up. And, hey, happy you're here, you know. He's very, but just, you know, very businesslike. He's ready. He's ready to coach this game. He's ready to coach this game. Has his game face on. Again, he didn't have on the lama's robes, the Rinpoche robes, the Tulku robes, the Tibetan Buddhist robes at all. No, it was Western business attire, casual elegance, casual business, actually. You know, just, and he'd fit right in here in the contemporary world like this. You know, he's here to coach this game. That's it. This is a big responsibility. But for him, you know, he's ready. I didn't see any concern on his face at all. Totally confident, super confident. Because he knows. He knows. Pure perception's within everyone. God has already placed it there within everyone. Nobody can touch it. It doesn't matter how many times you die, you never touch pure perception. We're all trying to get rid of it by dying. Because you think, continuity fear keeps lying to us and saying, that'll throw me into the abyss. I'd rather die than go into the abyss. Because at least with the dead, I don't experience anything. But if I get thrown into the abyss, I'll be like a living death. I'll be like screaming in terror, constant terror. No, pure perception just shows us inherent spaciousness of everything. And we still see all the decoration, beautiful decoration, ornamentation of pure spaciousness. There's no abyss. It's absolute fullness. How could you, if you're everywhere, how could you be in an abyss and losing yourself? Yes, impossible. We are it, and we are inescapably it. It's not out there. We don't find Buddha mind. We are it. We are Buddha mind. You can't never find it. How could you find what you are? That would imply dualism, that it's outside of you somehow. We don't find it. You never find it. We are inescapably it. There's only it. There's only it. It is it. This is it. And so, the game is getting about ready to begin. It's getting close now, isn't it? And so I showed up, and so I'm, you know, going to warm up my cheerleading capabilities and voice is a work in, it's a work in progress, but the potential is there. We'll see. We'll see if it comes around or not. I don't know. I don't know if I'm too old for that. Really, I mean, if I was like 20 something, look out. But you know, who's to say? I'm not gonna put it past me. I'm working out. And strengthening the core. You know, it's singing, it's about the core, but the vocal cords, yeah, you know, you get a little old and they may start getting a little, you know, the voice may start breaking. That's okay. I can make that work too. It's all about super confidence. If you really want to sing it out, cheerlead it out, you got to be super confident. Super confident. Super positive, super confident. People are helping me too. The diaphragm, just strengthening the core, strengthens the diaphragm. And of course, you use the diaphragm. If you really want to sing right, you have to have a very powerful diaphragm. You can just squeeze out the notes then, actually. You're not trying to sing with your throat and mouth, you know. You just like squeeze it with your diaphragm and boom, it comes out. So relentlessly, I'm ostensibly, you know, coaches say, you got to get ready for golf. We got to be a really good golfer. And I say, coach, I don't even want to play golf. You know, it beats the heck out of me. And, you know, it's really nice course. Yeah, it's kind of cool for sure. But unless it's really, really beautiful course, And it's not too difficult, you know. It's really kind of a drag, actually, to tell you the truth. So he said, "Dad, get ready." So I'm doing all these exercises to strengthen my core for golf, you know. And it's actually strengthening my whole diaphragm for singing, too, or for singing it out, for cheerleading, actually. For cheerleading, not necessarily singing. Who's to say I'm just going to sing? I don't just sing. You know, singing is for positivists. What I do is I just belt out a whole spiel of cheerleading for eternal life. You know, and whatever comes up, comes up. I'm not boxed in to some song, right? I'm not doing some art. I am the art. I am art itself, actually. I am art itself. Say that. I am art itself. Say that. I am art itself. I'm not doing art. I am the art. See, positives say, I'm an artist. I'm doing art. Super, super confident says, I am art. And there's only art. That's all there is. That's what I am. I am art. Try that on. And that's what I was doing today. It's like performance art. I am art. Everything is just whatever arises is just transformed into, you know, super positivity, super confidence. And I say, that's what I've been looking for my whole life. I've been looking for the cheerleaders for eternal life, for truth. Cheerleaders. Where are the cheerleaders? Oh my God. The thing about the cheerleaders is they know who the coach is, you see. They know who the coach is. They got a coach. They're not saying, hey, you know, I'm it. They say, no, the coach is it. Okay. I'm just cheerleading for the side as much as I can. But the coach got the big picture in mind. The coach knows the timing, what, when to say when to do what, when to push this button, when to do that. They got the whole plan in front of them from the beginning to the end. That's the coach. So let the coach be the coach. They'll just be the cheerleaders. There is no pressure on us to be anything other than super positive, super confident cheerleaders, right? That's all we got to do. I don't have to be some guru. The coach is the guru. Coach guru. I just need to just be a super positive cheerleader. Yeah. Go team, go. Go team, go. Go team, go. Go team, go. And I'm just never say die, you know, like a sports team. I never say die. I said, no. They got them just where they want them. You know, we're not out of it yet. No way. We're going to get the next game for sure. That's going to turn the tide, and we're going to win it. That kind of thing. So I had a brief moment of just, you know, just kind of my nerves just, I was just weeping. I said, why am I weeping? I feel so, just sobbing and weeping. And then now I've, you know, okay, it's fine. I wowed it. I said, wow, this is a wow. Came out of it. And now I'm on the sidelines. Go team, go. Go team, go. Go team, go. Go team, go. And remember, it's all about super positivity, super confidence for us. Super confidence means we got confidence in the coach and what the coach is coaching us on, right? Coaching us up for what? Eternal life? Something to attain, something to gain, something to generate? No. Why do we need to generate what we already are? Why do we need to get back to where we never left? Why do we need to wake up when we never went to sleep? We don't need to wake up. We're already awake. We're so into this, you know, trying to wake up the spiritual path. This blinds us to the fact we're already awake. And then we say, well, how do we wake up? I got to know so I can help others. No, we never went to sleep. Nobody ever went to sleep. So this answers the riddle of how do I help others wake up? You don't, because they're not asleep. Well, they're sure acting like they're asleep. But they're pretending they're asleep. They never went to the... How can the Son of God go to sleep? That's ridiculous. How can the mind go to sleep? That's absurd. It's absurd. So Longchenpa gave me this transmission. I wouldn't have got this without his transmission. His presence transmitted this to me. When I got it, I just said, what? I said, oh, wow. Immediately I said, oh, wow. This is just a radical paradigm shift. Holy cow. And I just wowed it. And I'm still wowing it. But I'm doing okay. I'm not even looking into it. That's when I went to the comedy thing and everything, all that stuff. I'm not gonna look at cheerleading. I'm not gonna look into it really. Just let it be. Just let the ripples, you know, let the ripples do what they're gonna do to the lotus flowers, you know. Maybe it's going to, the lotus flowers are gonna like start blooming or something. I don't know. Whatever happens, happens, right? I'll just keep cheerleading. But this is very profound. This is so profound. I say only a Dharma king could bring about this kind of realization. This is a radical Zog generalization that happened, to say the least. And it's a very pragmatic. It's even more pragmatic. I mean, the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness was wonderful, but this is really the heart of pragmatism. It puts all our defensiveness and everything that's going on into right context. Oh my God, we're just trying to fool ourselves in believing we could go to sleep and dream, because how else are we going to believe we're different than God except dreaming about it? So isn't it convenient to believe we can fall asleep and dream? But guess what? We can't fall asleep and dream. Part of singing good is you get to sing bad, too. That's part of super confidence. It's part of the shtick, you know. You just blah, 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 blah. It's part of the whole cheerleading thing. Like, hey, you know, don't get caught up in positivism. You know, positivism says, you got to sing the song right. You know, you got to make us feel positive. No, I don't. My job is to help us catch the super positive bug, which is the super confidence thing. I never fell asleep, so I don't have to wake up. I'm not awake. I never fell asleep. So I don't have to answer how I woke up. Nobody does. So I keep working out, and wow, I'm hitting the sides, you know, the sides, and twisting and strengthening the sides. A lot of people just work on their abdomens, get the washboard look like, hey, I'm really fit, you know, young and fit and lean and mean and all that stuff. It's the sides that are important, actually. And very few work out the sides in the right way, but I gotta say, I keep saying, I gotta hit the, you know, I gotta get more yardage on my drives, you know. I gotta hit at least 275, 280, you know. No way I'm gonna get there unless I got this really strong side, so I keep working out on this. I still don't know if I can get it 280, you know, I don't know. But it's strengthening, you know, the overall core. And I realize my singing is the endurance isn't there. The voice is you know, it gets, by practicing it gets weak and it breaks, but the zest is there, the pop is there, you know. And I have a buddy who's a singer in musicals. He's doing a musical right now. He's in the ensemble, and he told me that. I didn't know he was doing that. I said, wow. And I just realized, hey, recently I've been singing as if I was in a musical sort of, and I did it again today. It's like, whoa, that's way better than just trying to sing a song, you know. Like, what is that, trying to sing a song? I mean, the musical, you got zest. to what you're doing, and you got body language to it, and you're emoting. The song is just there. It's just, you know, you can use the song, but really you're emoting something more than the song, more than the song. You're not some pop singer crooner, you know, trying to make the teeny bopper swoon or something. You're giving this super positive zest out, is what it is. So I'm singing very zestfully, you might say. And it's like, yeah, I could do this. In fact, I was super good at it. If I let it happen, if I practice it, well, I'm super confident, super, why not say super, super, super great, super confident, super positive. It's there for all of us, actually. I don't have to worry about waking up, you see, because I never went to sleep. Nobody did. So why do we have to worry about waking up? So why don't we just start being zestful, right? Like that, just being zestful. And so, you know, just... And then, hey, you know, off to some other talk. You don't have to finish the song. It's just accenting. You're being overall zestfulness. And what happened to the song? Oh, it went into something more beautifully. It just melds into this, and this melds into this, and this morphs into this, and there's all this morphing keeps going, and it's just like, wow, I like this morphingness. Because the musicals, you know, they're singing and they're dancing and they're kind of hamming it up a little bit to over, you know, but they're giving you this feeling like, I've never been a big fan of musicals, I don't know, but, you know, there's something, at least there's something to that way of singing. Just kind of overplay it a little bit, make it bigger than life. And make it creative. Why do we have to sing in the same pop genre, you know, whatever genre is out there? You know, this is nonsense. This is just positivity. You know, running interference for negativity, actually. I don't have to sing that way. Nobody has to sing like that. Life is a cabaret. Life can be a song. Everything's a song. But it doesn't have to be put into the form of a song, necessarily, does it? Just let your creativity flow. Just let your creativity flow. But there's really nobody doing that. I mean, really, I haven't run into it. And singing motively and zestfully. You know, some of the great singers do that. You know, they can do it. Like Barbara Streisand's a pretty good singer, and she puts some, you know, zest or vitality and emoting into it. You know, some of these really great singers, they know how to really, they got a lot of energy. They can put it into the song, so to speak. I don't listen to Barbara Streisand, but I know she's a good singer. There's plenty of good singers. Of course, George Jones is the master of all masters at it, and everything he does is just emoting in zest. I mean, it's just ridiculous. It's like easy, relaxed zest. You know, it's like, wow. Okay. Boom, yeah, but it's just like, you know, okay. Is that take good? Okay, I gotta split, and I'm going to go somewhere and take off and have some fun. It's like no trouble at all. Oh, you want me to cut an album? Oh, okay, sure, let's cut it. How long gonna take? Let's do it. You know, let's do it today. We're gonna do it 8 hours. Boom, 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 boom. See you later. No big deal. That's, you might say, super confidence. Super confidence. Whatever, you know, you need a song. Okay, whatever. Let's just get it done. I got a lot of stuff to do. I got to go drive through the, you know, backwoods of Georgia or something. Georgia. We got to break out of this hillbilly mentality of the modern world. Modern world is a bunch of hillbillies. I mean, it's not, and going back to the real hillbillies is helpful, you know, because it helps us break out of the straitjacket we're in. Like we're smart. We think we're smart. No, we're idiots. We're death-worshipping idiots watching this death movie, this death horror show we call the world. It's just this ridiculous movie we're showing ourselves, trying to convince ourselves we've fallen asleep and are dreaming. Actually. And figure out, well, how can we get back? You know, somehow something weird happened to reality. How do we get back to it? You know, no, there's no getting back to it because there's no leaving it. So I break out the accents. I do the whole shtick of the hillbilly shtick, the redneck shtick, all this kind of stuff, because you know what? That's less pretentious, isn't it? We've gotten way too pretentious. World's gotten way too pretentious, way overconfident. The sign of positivity is overconfidence. That's what it is. Overconfidence. In what? In positivity. As if you pile it higher and deeper, PhD, pile higher and deeper, somehow you're going to convince yourself to get in that coffin. And you guess what? You get to convince others too. And you're going to be the savior of what? Of our dreaming? That's what you're dying is trying to convince ourselves we're dreaming, is it not? Isn't suffering just an attempt to convince ourselves we're dreaming? We must be dreaming. We're suffering. No, we're pretending. That's different than dreaming. We didn't fall asleep. We're pretending to be asleep, but we're not asleep at all. We're pretending to be dreaming, but we're not dreaming at all. We're wide awake, actually. We're absolutely wide awake. We're just pretending. It's all pretense. But we're trying to convince ourselves that we fell asleep. How else could we be dying, you know? Well, we're not dying. We're pretending to die, is all. I mean, there's never been worse rednecks right now than the modern culturists, you know. I mean, they're hicks from the sticks. It's just unbelievable how blind they are, how inbred they are in their ideas. You talk about inbreds. I mean, they're so inbred, you know. It's so incestuous. Their inbreeding, and far as their ridiculously stupid ideas go, is just unbelievable, isn't it? I mean, they all got the same education, the same ideas, the same ridiculous teachings, and that's all they ever hang out with, people who regurgitate the same things. I mean, and they've become these ridiculously overbred inbreds that just, you know, can't stand any talk about anything else. It just gives them a fit of the vapors, you know. You get a little super positive, they go, ah. I think I've got a fit of the vapors. I just can't, and I can't stay awake. Give me the smelling salts. Give me the smelling salts. Oh. Yeah, they act like they need smelling salts. What? Yeah, they all got this nice little hysteria fit, fainting fit. Like those delicate flowers of the south, you know, got a fainting fit. Yeah, they're so inbred they get a fainting fit if they hear anything faintly resembling the truth. How inbred is that? So the way to get out of that is start bringing in some, you know, real ideas. Get the genetics better, you know, the ideational genetics better. Start bringing in some, you know, more robust stuff. It's like it could be of hardier mental stock. I never fell asleep. Nobody's ever fallen asleep. How can the mind, which is ever present and aware, fall asleep? What a ridiculous notion. We'll laugh at that. What an absurd notion. But here you go into this world, you know, that everybody's pretending to be asleep, and you think, man, I better pretend to be asleep. But in my case, I had such a difficult time. I had to, like, you know, overcompensate like crazy to pretend to be asleep, so I ended up being super depressed, which, you know, I walk around town and say, is this okay, everybody? You know, is this good enough for y'all? And I sure hope so, because I feel terrible. And they'd say, well, you know, I don't know. not quite good enough. Yeah. Well, what about mine? How's mine? Well, yeah, you're doing a pretty good job pretending to be dead. You know, just what do you mean by that? You know. Yeah, how do I even know I'm pretending to be dead? You know, oh, yeah, I forgot. I better be more depressed and, you know, despondent. Walk along, like, sluggishly shuffling along. And said, yeah, I'm really headed for the coffin. I'm telling you, folks, I'm headed for the grave. You know I am. In fact, I'm going to get there sooner than you are. The way I feel, maybe today, maybe tomorrow. Yeah, that's how I live. I live. I said, I'm going to die today for sure. I feel so terrible. I felt so terrible. I was sure I was going to die that very day. And when I didn't, every single night, I was very surprised. I said, what the heck happened? I said, well, I'm sure I'll probably die in my sleep then. And I woke up in the morning, I was always shocked. I said, what the heck's going on? I thought I'd be dead by now. That's how bad I felt. For decades, I was like that. Because I felt it's the only way I could be in this world. It's the only way I could be in this world. Either that or super positive, super confident. But they don't allow it here. They say, you can't do that here. Come on. Just do, you know, come on. We're all in this together. You know, we're all headed for the grave together. You know, let's all do it together. That way, you know, nobody's going to be higher or lower than everybody else. And I said, well, wait a minute. You know, in reality, nobody's higher. In eternal life, nobody's higher or lower than anybody else. So if you really want that, then choose eternal life. And you're actually trying to be higher than eternal life by trying to change reality. I said, what, are you trying to be smart or something? I said, no, I'm trying to be super smart. I'm not trying, I am super smart. I'm super confident. And they say, well, you can't be that here. Says who? He says, well, it says everybody. Well, everybody's mistaken then. Time to figure that, time to experience that. Isn't that great? Get the opportunity to experience, wow, I was mistaken. And put that mistake in your rearview mirror. You stop being a moron when you realize you're a moron. That's how you stop being a moron. You say, wow, I'm a moron. And then right that instant, you're no longer a moron. A moron is someone who doesn't realize they're a moron, actually. And when they realize it, they're no longer a moron. It starts to be in their rearview mirror. They just passed it. And then you want to put as much distance as you can. You want it to disappear in your rearview mirror, you know, as fast as possible. So this is just a little sample, you know. Actually, I was like way more zestful today. I've toned it way, way down. Toned it way down, you know. But because I don't want to come on too strong. Cheerleader, let's just give this real mild, you know. Yay, yay, team. Yay, yay, team. Yay, yay, team, you know, yay, yay, team, and just kind of get us going here. The coach is in the house, Coach Longchenpa is in the house, Coach Longchenpa is in the house, Coach Longchenpa is in the house, can you dig it? Yeah, he's just relaxed, this can be relaxed. He's not all tense or tight, saying, wow, got a big game, you know, big game coming up here. And no, he's just purposeful and smooth and doing, taking care of this. He knows exactly what to do. He says, I'm ready for this game, man. I got the plan. We got a plan for this game. And he's not all uptight. He's not giving us some, you know, pep talk or something like that. He's saying, guys, we got this game. You know, don't worry. I got it. No worries. Let me see. The light keeps shifting and changing here. So what do? We shift on the fly, don't we? We shift it. Let's bring the gain down a little bit. Give you a chance to just kind of like resuscitate from. Now, you know, see, the lack of super confident cheerleaders in this world is just the most astonishing thing I've ever seen. I said, wow. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time lasting. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Yeah, what was that? Peter, Paul, and Mary, right? Remember folk singing? It's pretty cool, huh? Pretty doggone cool. Kind of melancholy, though, some of it, wasn't it? Yeah. A little bit melancholy. We're not melancholy here, are we? No, actually not. Once you get the super confident bug, you know, wow, where's the melancholiness? And people say, calm down, you want to calm you down. Everybody say, look, we've got to help you, you know. If you keep this up, you're not going to taste the grave, my God, son. You're going to miss out on that. You don't want to miss out on that. That's something really special. Ain't that special? Well, it ain't that special, actually. In fact, I've done it 32 times, and it ain't special at all, you know. So what are you trying to sell me? You trying to turn me into an idiot here, or what? I mean, who are you trying to play for a fool? You better be careful you're trying to play for a fool here. Okay? But they do it anyway, you know. It's like, stupid is as stupid does. I mean, they're still cheerleading for it. Like, they don't care. They say, you don't know nothing. I say, really? Well, we'll see. You do your cheerleading, I'll do mine. And we'll have a good laugh about it in the end, won't we? And in fact, the more the other side is cheerleading for death, the more I cheer 10 times stronger for eternal life. Okay? Absolutely. So let them do their mischief. Every bit of mischief they do, it just motivates me to do 10 times more, you know, cheerleading for super positivity, super confidence. Makes me want to cough all the more. Actually, it's Longchenpa who does the coughing. I said, Longchenpa, cough, 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 cough. I'm going to start patting him on the back. You know, come on, come on. Get in there. Got to get that cough out. Cough on me, please. Cough on me, please. But actually, all he has to do is just walk past you. That's all you need. They said that about Jesus, did they not? All he has to do is walk past you. That's all. And you get the super confident bug. You got it. Once you got it, can't get rid of it. Can't get rid of it. Why do you want to get rid of it? Keep in mind, Pentecost, 40 days after Easter, Vajrayogini showed up, had this amazing dream on Pentecost. She showed me this aversion therapy, which I've been using, which has been extremely helpful. Extremely, it helped me break through this barrier, actually. So I don't want to offend any of the fine sensibilities, you know. Well, you know what? I mean, you know, maggots. I mean, what is I looking at? Maggots? I mean, if they want to lead us to the grave, then why don't they lead us to maggots? Are they not? And pus and separating flesh and rotting, stinky flesh. I mean, that's what they're leading us to. Keep in mind, Sri Sri Anandamayi on several occasions, I don't know how many, dropped dead at the feet of her devotees because they said, hey, we don't really want what you're teaching us here. We want you to teach the, you know, the goddess worshiping stuff that we're used to. And so she said, oh, okay, fine. See you later. So she dropped dead at their feet, and her body immediately started rotting, like a corpse that had been lying in the street. You know, it was just the flesh was just rotting off the bones, and it was stinking, and there was all this pus and infection and maggots and everything in her body. Right away. And they just, you know, were repulsed by it, and it just shocked the heck out of them, and they said, whoa, 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 and talk about faith, you know. They said, come back, please. We know you can come back. How about that? He says, we know you've got the power to raise yourself from the dead, even this rotting corpse state. You can. We believe you can do it. We know you can do it. And boom, she resurrected herself from that state, just like that. That's Vajrayogini, that's Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma for you, folks. And you talk about hanging out with super positivity. Well, I've been hanging out with her since 1997. Formally. Before that, I'm sure I've been aware of her my entire life, actually. But formally, since 1997, October 27th, 1997, you talk about someone whose every step was a benediction of super confidence. That's it right there. In fact, it's so super confident, it's like kind of hard to finish that drink in one step. It's kind of like a kale smoothie. I mean, yeah, I was trying to finish this kale smoothie. I mean, I put together this kale smoothie last night. That was a kale smoothie for the ages. Half a package of Tuscan kale, and then half a package of spinach. But the spinach was old, and it was kind of getting slushy, you know, and mushy. And I looked at it, you know, I got to throw that out. I said, nope, I'm putting in a smoothie. It's going to get all blended anyway, so I might as well do it. So half a package of both of those. Yeah, then what the heck else did I do? You know, I don't know. Well, I put in a whole scoop of that vega one protein powder, and a scoop of chocolate protein powder, and then the tropical body armor tropical punch electrolyte drink, sports recovery drink, and I blended that son of a gun up, and strained the pulp out, and then started trying to chug it, and I could not chug that. I couldn't chug it, and so I just like pour a mouthful and then swish it around, get it down. And I kept doing that. Then I started looking at the bottom of that big, tall carafe, whatever you call it, pitcher. I said, man, I don't think I'm going to get to the bottom of this. It's getting harder and harder. And so I tried one more. Let me chug. And I said, I think that's the last one, because if I drink anymore, I'm going to upchuck all this. I mean, this, I can't do anymore. I said, wow. So I took a break, you know, walking around, stretching, you know. I said, wow, gotta try it. Well, yeah, gotta forget this. And I said, no, you know what? I just can't do it. So, I put in some banana strawberry protein smoothie also in that thing. Plus some banana. Yeah. Oh, was that this? Yeah. No, that's what I put. I didn't put the electrolyte drink in. That was a smoothie today. I put in this banana strawberry thing with some banana. And that, you know, it was rough. So I put it in the fridge, and in the morning time I got up and I, you know, finished it off. So that was an intense smoothie. I mean, if I can't finish off a smoothie, and my stomach was kind of hurting during the night. I mean, it's just thinking about it hurts my stomach. My advice is don't mix the kale and the spinach. If you do straight spinach, it's fine. If you do straight kale, it's fine. Don't put the two in. Don't do it if it's slushy, you know, starting to get mushy. Yeah, I don't know. Use fresh stuff. Okay. The kale, the great thing about kale is it stays fresh in your fridge forever. Tuscan kale, it's been in there for a month, still as fresh as daisy. But the spinach, it all sticks to itself and starts, you know, kind of just rotting, doesn't it? So don't do that. Go for the kale. Kale's really great. But for somehow, I haven't been getting as tired during the day, and I'm not getting hardly any sleep, but I've got some sort of push. I don't know if it's the kale smoothie, but it's the last 2 days since I've done this kale smoothies at night. I've had energy during the day, and it may be the Vega 1 protein powder also. Possible. It may have all these nutrients. It may be that there's very balanced nutrient that somehow helps us. It's possible, because I mean, whey is just protein powder. Some of these protein powders, that's all they got. They don't have the full balance of all these vitamins and minerals and all this various stuff, but the Vega one has all that. It's got a lot of stuff in it that's gives you all sorts of trace this and trace that and vitamins of all kinds of from natural ingredients, you know. It's expensive, yeah, but I understand why it's expensive. I mean, whey, that doesn't have to be expensive, because it's just, you know, you get it from processing dairy products, right? But the this Vega one has got so much stuff from organic, non-GMO veggies and all sorts of stuff. Wow, it's amazing. From beans and from flaxseed and from hemp and from all, you know, all these different sources. It's all non-GMO organic they get it from. And something has given me an extra kick. You know, maybe it's just a whole constellation of everything. Now, if I can just get enough kick to sing better. Yeah. But I'm using my voice all day long. I'm either talking, taping, talking, singing. I mean, I've been nonstop going, this was since this morning, since like 9 o'clock. And what is it now? It's almost 9 o'clock. Yeah, so it's like 12 straight hours of constant emoting. I've hardly been, wow. And working out. Hitting that core. My core is sore. I mean, I'm just one old, big old mass of soreness right now. The smoothie I made today was Body Armor Tropical Punch Electrolyte, you know, a sports recovery drink, a whole banana, chocolate protein drink, Bolt House chocolate protein drink. It's very delicious. And some coconut water, purity coconut juice. And then two big scoops of chocolate protein powder, whey chocolate protein powder, and then 2/3 of a dark chocolate bar, a really, really strong dark chocolate bar. Put that in the Nutribullet, and away we go. And the only problem is that the chocolate being real heavy, real strong dark chocolate, it doesn't really blend up with the rest so well. It chips, it gets in little chips. But during the day, it more and more blended as I drank this. I still have some left. That was pretty doggone good. Really good. And that gave me, you know, some strength. Because I got to repair all this damage I'm doing. Okay, you really got to, you know, get the protein going. Get the muscles repaired here. Get the voice like a Marshall amp on 12, or an Orange amp on 12. Use an Orange bass amp for your lead on 12, and you know, you've got your you know, your Kramer or your Strat or whatever, you know, just test it, you know, do a sound check, just whoa, and people kind of like turn like, what was that? Like the Les Paul Jr., Leslie West with his Les Paul Jr., you know, bank of whatever he had, you know, just ridiculous power to just, you know, just kind of do a riff or something, and just like all the roadies kind of stop, everybody stops and just like, whoa, yeah, this is what we're going to be hearing tonight. And let's be honest, you know, back in the day, when they came out with all those amplifiers and electric guitars and stuff, going to those concerts or hearing this stuff. I didn't go to many concerts because I, you know, it didn't dig the scene at all. There's too much auxiliary stuff going on. It's not good. Plus, it blows your ears out. And, you know, I just prefer to sit in my room and listen to it on headphones or something. But, or play, actually, I prefer to play it myself. I was more, you know, active voice. I said, oh, okay, Leslie West, I want to play like that. So I got a Les Paul Jr. said, I can play like that. I can play better than that, you know, as I feel. I can at least do as good as that. So I got the equipment, actually, would sit there in a room. We got this laundry room once, and we closed all the laundry room, a cement block laundry room, you know, just like, we're in there just as a college. A scourge of the dorms, I think, probably. Nobody wanted to be my friend there because I was that crazy guy playing the laundry room, just turning everything up, you know, max, just absolutely rocking out. I rocked out big time, to say the least. But it was soulful. It was all, everything I did was soulful. It wasn't, you know, hair glam, you know, stuff of just, you know, let's party. None of that. No, it wasn't Let's Party. Never. It was always soulful. Whether it was the blues, I played a lot of blues. I loved playing the blues because it's soulful. It emotes, right? It's very emoting. You can really emote with the blues. It's the nuances there. You know, just these subtle little nuances. It's very creative. The blues can be very creative. Eric Clapton is like the best at it. I mean, he just hits one note and it's just like, wow. Because he's got this, you know, maybe it's received pronunciation, maybe it's his RP education in England. He's got that RP for guitar. So he knows just how to emote properly and play the blues so nicely. But it's just like, it's just like, wow. So Clapton gets this wow kind of going thing, you know, it's still positivity, but less is more. And then, you know, blues rock, I played a lot of blues rock, I really love blues rock, which is a faster, more up-tempo, love rhythm and blues. It's hard to play because that's more of a instrumental, you know, got brass sections and more of a singing type of thing. But if you're doing instrumentals, it's more difficult. And hard rock, did hard rock for sure. Rock and roll, did rock and roll. But it was emotive too. Which was trying to produce a super confident sound. I tried to produce a super confident sound through music. But it's using this genre, you see, of music. It's an art form that isn't super confident, super positivity. Super positivity encompasses a 360 degree. You're in it. You're not in it. You are it. You can't stop being it. It's literally, you know, hey, it's live performance art. You are it. So you can't just sit there and play guitar. It doesn't work. And I got so frustrated because I said, maybe I can, people will say I can't be super positive in the world, but maybe if I play, you know, this fantastic guitar, they'll say, oh, like, it's okay. No. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. Drives musicians crazy. I mean, drove Clapton into all sorts of troubles, right? And everyone who's trying to be super positive through music, it drives them nuts because it doesn't work. It doesn't work. So I probably drive people, audiences nuts if I play guitar now. I could get back into it, sure. But I drive them nuts because I, you know, do a riff and I just stop and just do something else, you know, like, why? You know, what do you mean? You want to hear it? Did you hear it? What do you mean you heard it? If you heard it, you'd be wowing it. What are you talking to me for? You know, I boo. You know, it's like booing Dylan at Newport. Because, hey, you know, where's your folk stuff, man? You went electric, man. And Dylan says, what do you mean? I'm at the man. You're the man. But now I drive nuts. Like Ramana Maharshi said, I can't marry. No woman would marry me. I'd drive her nuts. She'd run away. And so how can I, you know, do art or do music? I can't do music, really. I want to be entertained. I want to catch the positive vibe as I march on my way to the coffin, you know. I want to be a happy coffin dweller. I want to get there in a happy mood. I want to get to death in a happy mood. So make me happy. Make me positive. And they want that from the art. You know, they want that. But I keep doing this stuff. What are you doing? It's like, are you nuts? You know, positively, super positively nuts. Yeah, I'm super positively nuts. Absolutely. Got the bug. I got the plague. I got the super positive plague. I'm a goner. You know, I'm absolutely gone. 8 miles high. And not touching down, though. Ground control to Major Tom. Hey. Major Tom isn't answering anymore, you know. Major Tom is not answering. He's you know, he said, I'm having too much fun up here. Come on. I'm having too much super positivity up here. Wow. I'm having too much wow up here. So we just use music in and out, toss it there, you know, whatever comes in, you know. She's like, what is this? You know, wow. Stop. I need the positivity, you know. I'm losing my train of positivity here. Yeah, you're catching the bug of super positivity. No, but whatever. You know, then I won't be able to die. I want to die. I got to die. Everybody's dying, you know. I don't want to make them feel bad. I want to have to go to the grave by themselves. I got to follow them there, you know. And say, don't worry, you know, I died too. You know, oh, yeah, it was so terrible I died, but you died too. That makes me feel so much better, you know. Whoa. Oh, yeah, tack it up, baby, gonna shut you down. Somebody burning rubber happened on the strip. Wait one night, two cool cats standing side by side. Well, if you inject a stingray and a 413, ripping up our engines, and we sound real mean. Tack it up, baby, gonna shut you down. Pop, 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 pop. That's done all a whisper voice because I'm outside, it's late at night, and I don't want to wake up the neighbors. Somebody was just laying rubber out there, peeling out. Wow. He says, check this out, pedal and metal time. That's kind of cool. We saw the most outrageous hot rod coming out of church Sunday. It was parked next to our car. Holy smack-a-moly. I mean... This thing, you have never seen a car like this before. It was ridiculous. I can't even describe it. I cannot even describe this car. It was a Chevrolet, had a Chevrolet emblem on it, but man, we just had to laugh at that thing. I mean, somebody had just got this thing, like, man, it looked like a hillbilly hot rod, I'm telling you. it's got wood in it. It's got a little rustedness. It's stressed look. Got these massive, I mean, the exhaust pipes come right out of the engine, like antlers, you know, just huge chrome antlers coming out like 3 feet out. Yeah. And the whole thing's chopped. And if it's like a front, is like some real, real low, narrow chop thing. But you know, it's just like, how could you describe this thing? It's impossible. And we were just looking at it and laughing at it. Wow. Wow, driving that thing around would be a kick, wouldn't it? A real kick. Somebody has a sense of humor. I mean, that isn't just chic. I mean, that's like, I don't know, there's not even a word for it. That was what's so cool about it. This defies any genre, any word. There's nothing you can say. Just laugh. We just laughed. Just have to laugh at it. I mean, that's it. Yeah, you get it, you know. If it's you laughing, then you'd probably say, ah, you get it. Somebody gets it. You say, dig my custom machine. Yeah. Just got washed my car, sure looks pretty. Chrome reverse wheels. Let's see. Just got my car, sure looks pretty. Chrome reverse wheels. See. How's that go? That's a really nice car. A really nice song. Chrome reverse wheels, sure looks pretty. Just waxed my car. Da 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 da. Chrome reverse wheels, it sure looks pretty. I'm gonna get my chicken, take her out to Drag City. Bum 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 bum, and woo, what'll she do now? Yeah, that one song. Gonna Drag City. That's Jan and Dean. I can get the lyrics of Jan and Dean. Yeah, beautiful song, man. Oh wow. I mean, that music still just is a kick. I mean, it's an absolute zesty kick to it. Wow. I'm going to listen to that. I got to look it up. I'm going to look it up. It's worth looking up. Get these zesty songs, okay? Don't just keep going. Don't be a slave to cultural fashion. Refuse to be a slave to cultural fashion, okay? And find the zest. Start getting a little bit zesty. You think you're coming down with a bad case of super positivity, son? And you know what? My prescription is just bed rest for you. I'm not going to send you any doctor. My prescription is more of the same, actually. Don't go to any doctor. You know, I'm the doctor here. I'll wear a white lab coat for you. I'm the doctor, Dr. Ross. And I'm just says, you know, yeah, you'll be okay. You're just coming down with a nice case of super positivity. You should be fine. Take two aspirin and call me in the morning. Let's see if we can get to this. Yeah. Okay. I don't want to shut anything down that I should not shut down. You never know. Never know with computers. So keep say, hey, Longchenpa, cough on me. Tell him, he'll cough on you. Tell him. I'm telling. He responds. Longchenpa responds. Tell him, Longchenpa, please cough on me. Oh, good. So a helicopter's going over and I can't even talk anyway. Okay, here we go, folks. As this helicopter passes. Burn up that quarter mile. Just tuned my car. Now she really peels. Looking real tough with chrome reverse wheels. A blue coral wax job sure looks pretty. Gonna get my chicken, make it out to Drag City. Dun, 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 dun. And a woo-hoo-hoo. Run her through now. I'm going to Drag City, running through now, going to Drag City, what'll she do now? And the background's going, woo, going to Drag City, run her through now, going to Drag City, what'll she do now? Burn up that quarter mile. Okay. The DJ saying I'm my favorite station. The Drag City races are the fastest in the nation. Wheels are the wildest and the stalkers are pretty. I'll get my honey, grab some money, split to Drag City. What I'm going to Drag City, what'll she do now? That is one heck of a song. Wow. I could even listen to this now, couldn't I? Yeah. I could do that, right? Like, I could do that. Can I get out of the box of a video? Can I get out of this box? Am I supposed to be locked into a taping box here? I don't know. Maybe not. Jen and Dean. I think they have it in stereo right now. If they can, if this will search, or if Google, if YouTube will do the search for me. Don't love it a little, love it a lot. This is a advertisement for Chromecast. Chromecast, I tried that. The software wouldn't work. Come on, Google, you can do better than that. Because your operating system is too old. Something, I don't know. You got to keep upgrading your operating system all the time. I said, forget it. It doesn't even fit on my computer. Can't do that. Come on, man. Give me this page. Don't love it a little, love it a lot. There it is. Drag City, Jan and Dean, 378,000 views. So it's not exactly unlistened to, is it? So I'm going to put this on right now. Why not? What else we got to do? As we keep it, we got coming down with a bad case of super positivity. Well, join the crowd. Join the crowd. But I can't even, can I hear it or do I have it on mute? I have the taping on mute, but I, mouse freezes up as it, look. Oh, I'm hearing it. Holy cow. Burn up that quarter mile. Really peels, chrome, suck. Oh, I don't have the lyrics. Because I opened up different page. Gonna get my chicken, take her out to Drag City. And a woo! Gotta go way up there for them. What'll she do now? Woo! Can't reach it. See, I'm a flat on it. But I was young, I could hit that great. That quarter mile. Nice. Ah, it's got an advertisement for Hemorrhoid Hillary there. Ah, God. And a woo, what'll she do now? 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 Burn up that quarter mile. They left out the final verse on that lyric thing. Look pretty. The Dag City. And a woo, what'll she do now? Woo, what'll she do now? Just go down an octave, That's the way to deal with the falsetto if you can't handle it. What'll she do now? Burn up that quarter mile. Burn up that quarter mile. One quarter mile. Yeah, one quarter mile. Yeah, one quarter mile. This is a kick. This song is a kick. This song just kicks. Anyway, that was a sort of voce fooling around thing. I'll do it like full. I can't hit the falsetto yet. That's so. Gotta get the voices really. Gotta be drink the lemonade. Maybe it'll help. They really go up high, Jan and Dean, because they're Courtney was like, they're 20 or something, young, you know. Man, when I was young, I could sing falsetto. So I could do it even when in my 30s and 40s. Really, really good. I could do the whole thing, super high falsetto, all the way down to bass. That was my range. Now I can get down to bass, but I can't do the super high falsetto. I can do falsetto, but not that super high stuff. Of course, you didn't hear how high it was, so you didn't even know. If I hadn't told you, you wouldn't have known. But I said, forget it. Again, I can't hang with those guys, not unless my voice is like really, then the vocal cords got to be, you know, lemonade kind of shrinks the vocal cords, gets them really taut, and then you can pop, you can really pop the higher stuff really well. Honey helps relax them or smooth them out. So a mixture of honey and lemonade helps you with certain stuff, higher stuff, honky-tonk stuff. It doesn't necessarily help you with crooning, but I don't know, I experience it helps me with everything. Some people, you know, disagreed. I told the singer that. He said, what? My singing teachers told me never to drink lemonade. That's not good. I said, huh, really? So I had probably, you know, different points of view on all that kind of stuff. But everybody, all singers have their secret concoction that helps them. Unfortunately, George Jones was usually out of an alcohol bottle. He did drink the lemonade and honey, though. But, yeah, he just loosened up with getting, you know, plastered, and somehow didn't affect the singing, but he relaxed so much, he lost all his inhibitions, and he'd just have a good old time. But, you know, it took a severe toll on his health, an extremely severe toll on his health, which is a shame. And he smoked a lot, which, you know, had an effect on his voice. The MusiCorps years was the best. I mean, some of that MusiCorps stuff, good Lord. Yeah, he just comes on. I just stop. It's out of control. Like the song "Out of Control" by George Jones. I can even hit that on here. I got everything on here. YouTube. You can't hear it, but I can talk about it, can't I? And again, the zest of super positivity is everywhere, right? Do we have to stay on? Well, come on, I can't type with the darn. There you go. Out George Jones, Out of Control. Listen, you want to hear a great honky tonk song? Listen to this song. It's got a lot of great ones, but this one, you know, it rocks. It's just, man, oh man. It's something else. You can go to YouTube. You can go to YouTube right now and listen to it. Out of Control, George Jones. What goes wrong with the mind of a man in a bar who sits and keeps drinking with his thoughts strayed so far? Yeah. It's the same old sad story that has often been told. One drink, then another, till he's out of control. Isn't that the story of our lives? Bad habits, start going to bad habits. And speaking of bad habits, yeah. The more creative you are, the worse bad habits are. Let me put George on pause. How about that? You see, I don't have to listen to the whole song. I just put George on pause. How about that? Because something more important came up. Bad habits. If you're really super positive, super creative, super confident, if you start getting into vices, you're in big trouble. Because you're so creative, you'll be super creative with it. I was thinking, like, I'm going to mix Cavita, you know, like a super probiotic drink, Cavita. And I said, oh my, with Cavita and gin. You know, like, if I was a drinker, I said, I'd get in trouble with Cavita. Because it's like, well, I can mix it with this. Before you know it, I've got like, I'm inventing 10 different drinks a night. I've got to try this one. Let me try this one. So I'd be like trying to come up with all these exotic, incredible, wonderful drinks, but I'd be like having to taste them, to sample them, say, how good is this? You know, before you know it, I'd be a raving alcoholic, and I'd be, on Skid Row, for sure. I mean, I've had enough trouble with vices in my life, and it's a dangerous thing for me because I'm so super creative. And you start getting creative with it. And then you think, well, I'm being creative, you know. So what's wrong with that? I'm just not some guy sitting, you know, what goes wrong with a man in a, what goes wrong with the mind of a man in a bar who sits and keeps drinking with his thoughts straight so far. No, I'm not. No, I'm being super creative with it. And so you fool yourself that way. And so a lot of really super creative people end up on Skid Row. They hit bottom. They really do. Their vices just devastate them because they're blinded to it. They don't realize what's happening. So I have to be super careful not to get into any vices, like ultra careful, which is to be aversion practice is very super helpful, super, super helpful. Because as George Jones, what's the song go? Let me see. Continues on. Second verse. He sits down at a table with his hands on a glass. For him, there's no future. There's only the past. He reaches for the bottle, but his hands don't take hold. His eyes just don't focus. He's out of control. Does he search for contentment that he might hope to find from a honky-tonk woman or the bottles of wine? He shakes and he trembles, even though he's not old, like a leaf in a whirlwind, he's out of control. Yes, I'm just like that fellow who sits there all alone, with no one to love me, no family at home. I'm a picture of others with a future so cold, a life ain't worth living when it's out of control. So this is testimony to what happens to us when we start dabbling in vices. Your goal is to be a super positive, super confident in this world. You cannot dabble with vices. You cannot. And I thought, wow, you know, nobody will let me be super positive. You know, maybe I can do this way or that way. And then you get frustrated and you start dabbling in vices. And before you know it, you're being super creative there too. That is mega danger. So you got to put the fear of God in you. You got to, because you got to absolutely knock off the vices. If you want to be super positive, you have to knock them out. I don't touch it. You know, I try to be pure as a driven snow. Got to be really disciplined about it. So if something starts getting you, aversion practice, man, just knock it out. Just knock it out. You start heading for the bottle and you just think you're drinking pus, you know, laced with every hideous, you know, with rotting bubonic plague boils in it, you know, and you're drinking, it's slithering down your throat. I mean, you got to think of something that grosses you out so bad that you just throw that bottle, like, it just, you throw it from you, like, in just horror, you know. It's just, you're absolutely horrified. You got to do it. This is why Vajrayogini, it was so extremely helpful to us to give us out this practice to the world right now, because this protects the super positives, and she's all about protecting them. Very protective. She's the mother hen, you know, that protects the super positives, the super confident ones, who are the cheerleaders for truth. She is like, you know, the den mother who's watching us very carefully and says, I'm not going to let you get into any vices. You got to knock it off now, you know, no way. So I'm going to give you this aversion, treatment, practice. And you start, your mind starts going around and around direction. You just hit that button, and you just imagine something that's so revolting that it just grosses you out. I mean, imagine like something in the refrigerator, like coconut water, it goes bad pretty quickly. There's all this bacteria, there's all these like black fuzzy mold on it that's just like moldy and rotty. And imagine like you're starting to drink this bottle, and you look and say, all this stuff is just slime and slithering down your throat. You know, it's just like, ah, and you just got to throw it in the trash. And you're like, you're shaking for a while. You know, you're just like, but then you calm down and say, oh, thank you. You just saved my life. You just saved my spiritual path. Because I was, one drink leads to another. Okay? Yeah. That's another George Jones song. One more. One drink, just one more, and then another. You know, this is, right? Yeah. This is what happens. And, of course, he was so super creative. He thought, well, I'm singing so great. I can just keep drinking and drinking and drinking and taking all these drugs and stuff. Before you knew it, he hit bottom. He didn't understand it. He thought, I'm still the king, you know. And it just took him a lifetime to figure it out. And he had to, you know, stop it. He had to stop it. Because people said, ah, George, you're singing great, man. Everything's great. We love you. And he says, hey, nothing wrong with me. Everybody loves me. super dangerous. Other people, they can handle the vices a lot better because, you know, they're just positives, you know. They're just, I got a vice, what the heck, you know. But not the super positives. The super positive always are just, man, I can do this and this and this and this with it, this, this, and this, and this, this. I can make a book about it, I make tons of books about it. I can just be like the best, you know, about this ever. But it's okay because, oh, it's a creative vice. I've been so creative with it, you know, wow. No. Aversion treatment to that immediately. Treat with aversion practice immediately. Immediately. I do it every day now. Just so I'm in practice. Think of something that just gives me the creeps. The shudders, the creeps. So I got that in my back pocket. It's like a pepper spray for myself, you know. I start I pepper spray myself. It's terrible. Yeah, but it's wonderful. Oh, thank you. I needed that. Thanks, I needed that. You know, people say, well, life is to be enjoyed. What they're really saying is vice is to be enjoyed. Life is a vice, actually. This belief where just fall asleep and dreaming, you know, of death, that's a vice. This dream of death is a vice. It's the worst. It's a terrible vice. It's a vicious vice. It's both a vicious vice and a vicious vice. We're in the vice of a vicious vice. V-I-S-E-I-C-E. What a difference a consonant makes. Yeah. Conveys what we need to convey. Let's turn to George on again. I just want to hear the king, the real king. Anybody can sing like Elvis, you know, a lot of people, but nah, I've never heard anyone sing like George Jones. Kenny Henson is the only one that can do it pretty decently. Merle Haggard could do it, you know, somewhat decently, but nobody can do it, actually. Elvis, thousands, you know, you can sing like him. I mean, Elvis sang great, but it's easy to sing like that. But Jones, wow. I mean, he's like a blacksmith hammering out steel or something. Yeah. Whack. Like a chariot racer driving that chariot. Ben Hur driving that chariot in the Circus of Rogue. Whack. Whack. Yeah, whack. It's going along. It's like, man. He's got this uber confidence at singing. You might even say it's close to super confidence. So let's see that. It's like, okay, wow. It's good practice. It's good practice trying to sing like that. Just sitting here. I can't play it for you because Google will copyright you. Flag it. Block it. There you go. And the thing is, he always seems relaxed and never reaching, like, what's the big deal, folks, you know? What's the big deal? He's the only guy in Nashville recording. Everybody else when he's in town would stop their recording sessions, cancel them, and come over and listen to him record. Truly, all the other artists would. Because it just like blew him away. I mean, he's just like, what's the big deal here? You know, relaxed. Give me the song. You got a song for me? Okay, let me see it. Okay, I'm good to go. Knock it out of the park. One or two takes. That's it. I'm like, what? This idea, I mean, he came up with it. I mean, all the ideas of how to sing it, he just comes up with it like that. And he'll sing it. George Jones can sing a song one way, and you say, that's the perfect way to sing that song. He just absolutely nailed it. There's no better way to sing that song. That's it. And then he'll sing it another way. You say, holy cow, that's perfect too. There's no better way to sing it than that. And he'll sing it a third way. You say, oh my God, you know, that's perfect. I mean, how do you do that? that's the talent he had, is he could sing it any which way, and you'd swear that's the right way to sing that song. And once he sings a song, somebody else tries to cover the song and sing it differently, he says, oh, that doesn't sound as good. That's not the way to sing the song. That's not right. And very few people have ever been able to cover a song that George Jones did and make it sound, you know, decent. It's very difficult. Very, very difficult. Because you say, oh, I mean, you're just trying too hard, but it's just, you know, it's not there. Too much trying on that one. Like, Jones is like, say, like, oh, trying? What's trying? I don't know what trying is. What do you mean try? I'm trying? Trying? I don't understand trying. And that's a super confident attitude. I try. I don't understand. I don't try. I don't even know what trying is. Trying is dying, actually. Trying is dying. I'm not dying here, I'm living. I'm life itself. I'm not even living, I am life. I am life. What is this? I am alive. No, I am life. I am life. That sounds like some, like, herbal multi-level company to be, right? I am life. You know, the Gobinka leaves from, you know, Indonesian. They found some Borneo, some expedition just got back from Borneo, and they found out the natives there, like, have been, like, curing everything with the Gobinka leaves. I mean, like, they brought some back. And now, you know, there's a mad gold rush onto the rainforest of Borneo to get those Gobinka leaves. Was it cure? Just about everything. Gobinka tea. There's always something like that. We now we're selling, you know, multi-level. Somebody got, we got Gobinka extract here. We got it in 20 different ways. The leaves, the extract. You take it in vitamin concentrate and vitamin pills. We extracted the essence of it, put in vitamin pills. You know, we got it, you know, you can smoke it. Yeah, put it in e-cigarettes. I mean, it's everything. We got Gobinka everywhere. And you can, you know, get a spot dealership too. And the more people you get in to be dealers, Gobinka dealers, the more money you make. It's all this wonderful pyramid. You know, and of course, only those who start these pyramids get rich off of it. That's their whole thing. They know if they start a pyramid, the more people they can pull into it, the richer they get. And anybody down the lower levels, are you kidding? They sucker all these people into it. Now, I mean, there's some positives to it. People get gung-ho about stuff and maybe motivates them for a while. Yeah. Wow. Those are weird situations. I've been to a couple of those conferences where we were like big wigs and yeah, they were recruiting us and, you know, all this stuff. And we were like at the head table and they took us to lunch and we were at the big wigs and they flew in. They always fly somebody in. You know, it's just ridiculous. The whole thing's choreographed. So it's just amazing how they choreograph it all to produce this, you know, this awe and, you know, wow, this is really, we feel in this doctor from somewhere and you feel in this really successful guy. He's like just the top seller and he's going to give you a pep talk, you know, and he's going to tell you how to do it. Well, he's at the top of the pyramid. That's how you do it. There's no doing it to it. He's telling you to sell more so he gets more money. All you got to be is at the top of the pyramid. Come on. I mean, you can't get there. Because if you're down later in the game, no matter what you do, there's always those who are in first, who are ahead of you, top of you, and your revenue stream, a lot of that's going to them. There's nothing you can do about that except grow the bottom of the pyramid even greater, which gives them even more revenue. Yeah, it's great for the one percenters, right? The pyramid schemes. It's not so good for the rest of us. But that's much ado about nothing. But it's the attitude you have, right, of course, as you do it, right? Absolutely. It's the super positivity, the super confidence. Coach Longchenpa. Get back to Coach Longchenpa. The coach is in the house. The coach is in the house. The coach is in the house. I gotta get my cheerleader voice on. Maybe that's why I'm doing this singing and this exercise, but I don't have it yet. it's there in bits and pieces. It's kind of like I can run up, you know, 2 flights of steps, but I can't do 20. But, you know, it might come. You never know. It's popping better every day. And the better you pop it, the more confident you get. You just say, ah. That track? Ah. Piece of cake. Watch me improvise on it. Because that's the thing. You get better, then you say, well, I shouldn't even say that. It's too easy. Let me improvise. And you start, you know, jamming this improvise, and then it like gives spaciousness to the whole thing. It's like it shifts it into super positivity, because you're not in the box of I have to follow along just with this. You're not in that box anymore. You're outside. You freed yourself from the box because you realize there is no box. There never was a box. I never fell asleep. Holy cow! I never fell asleep. That's Longchenpa's cough. I mean, he passes you by, he walks by, he didn't cough, he just hailed me. Hello, hi, Ross. And boom, I never fell asleep. How about that for a coach? How about that for a coach? How about getting coached up by Longchenpa, folks? You know? So I'm just telling you the gospel truth here, okay? This is what's happening. This is what has taken place in my life. It came as a complete surprise to me. It still is very wowish. If I think about it too much, it's just wow. But I try to just go with the flow and say, okay, let's keep up here. I mean, this is happening, and we're in a crisis right now. We are headed smack dab for a tremendous crisis in this world. I'm telling you. The other team is going to take the court, and there are some bad bruisers out there. Let me tell you. These folks are going to run you down into the grave. I said, hey, everybody, the movie about death just really got very interesting. You can't miss this movie. And I say, well, guess what? We are going to miss it this time around. Maybe next time we'll watch it, but not right now. Longchenpa, 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 Coachchenpa, 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 you know? Sing it out, sing it out, sing it out, Coachchenpa, Coachchenpa. You see how we just left Jones standing there? That's okay. He's still sitting on a bar stool with a glass in his hand. That's okay. He's on the back row. Here I sit on the back row of a church down the street, not too far from the place where we used to meet. And it's finally getting through to me, you found somebody new. But here I'll sit on the back row while you wed another man. That's another of like awesome, awesome songs called On the Back Row, or Back Row by George Jones. On the Back Row. What a incredible song that is. I never dreamed that after all the years I'd be still sitting here with just a bottle and 2 glasses right next to your favorite chair. Yeah. And who knows, one day one of those he might leave you, one day he might do you wrong, and here I'll be waiting for you all along, or something like that. I can, you know, if I hear it, I'll remember it. It's not a fancy place, he goes, and then he goes, just a tavern in the lonely part of town where lonely people try to find someone and hope to settle down. But fate dealt me the blow, and I can't understand. So here I sit on the back row as you wed another man. Yeah, it's finally getting through me. You found somebody new. Wow, finally getting through to me. You found somebody new. Here I sit on the back row. Well, you know, it's finally getting through to us that the world is worshiping death, isn't it? So we kind of like feel like singing a honky-tonk song or two. If my voice is good, I can sing the heck out of honky-tonk songs, because the honky-tonk songs emote this feeling of, you know, wow. It's the world's in love with death. It's not in love with God. It's in love with death. And imagining that God is like the head cheerleader for loving death, which is what loving the notion of separation, loving the notion of mind falling asleep, loving the notion of dreaming, loving the notion of impermanence, loving the notion, it's finally getting through to me. You know, you found somebody new. So here I sit on the back row. Yeah. Waiting for you all alone. Yeah. So we're waiting all alone. We're just waiting for everyone to come back to their sanity, you know, and yet no. They're going all in. They're going all in. Say, we got this mega dream of death for you to watch. It's gonna be more special effects. Look out for them. You got songs by such and such, and cameo appearances by this star. And this starlet's gonna take her clothes off. You know, wow, what an incredible death movie you got to watch here. And lots of gruesomeness coming up. And people say, wow, isn't this great? We're all gonna march to the grave together like lemmings. And nobody's gonna break ranks, because that'd make us feel bad. Gee, ain't that a shame? You're gonna feel bad. Well, maybe if you feel bad, you'll start wanting to feel good. Or maybe if you feel really bad, you'll want to start feeling super good. In fact, you will. In fact, you will. You say, wow, I really gotta start feeling super good. Yeah. So ain't nothing wrong with feeling a little, you know, feeling really bad when you're, you know, out of control. And your hands, you know, when your thoughts strayed so far, right? Yeah, he sits and keeps drinking with his thoughts strayed so far. So we keep drinking the bottle of death, at least the belief in death, with our thoughts strayed so far. In this bar room, in this honky-tonk bar room. Honky-tonk's this bar room with jukebox and maybe it's just entertainment. And you go in there and you drink, trying to forget how rough your life is. This is ridiculousness that we're engaged with as far as this movie we call world. It's like a honky-tonk. We're sitting in a honky-tonk. What goes wrong with the mind of a man in a bar who sits and keeps drinking with his thoughts strayed so far? It's the same old sad story that has often been told. One drink, then another, till he's out of control. So we come into this world and we get one vice after another, one bad habit there until we're out of control. We just, you know, gone. We can't understand what the heck Coach Longchenpa is talking about. He can't coach us up. That's a bad thing, isn't it? You want to be coached up by a great coach, don't you? I mean, isn't that what athletes want? What do athletes really want? They want great coaching, don't they? The really great ones. They're looking for the great coaches. Because they realize this great coach is going to coach me up and going to make me everything that I can be. They don't look for some lousy coach. The better you are at something, the better coach you want. So I've just been blessed. I've been absolutely blessed in my life by great, great coaches, spiritual coaches. Now get Longchenpa to coach me up. Wow. Degree super confident smoothness. He says, there's a game, bring it on. There's a contest, okay, bring it on. We're ready for you. Bring on the monsters. We're ready for you. Who put thumbs down on this song? I can't believe these people put thumbs down. What are they thinking? There's a bunch of people just go around. Their life is so out of control. They just got to put thumbs down on everything. Yeah, just wow. Really? I mean, there's some stuff you say. There's no way. Why would anyone spend their time putting thumbs down on this? Just let it go. If you don't want to listen, don't listen to it. Thumbs down, really? Shannon Dean's got 21 thumbs down. Why? Keep in mind, just got my car, really peels, looking real tough with chrome reverse wheels. Blue coral wax job sure looks pretty. Gonna get my chick and take her out to Drag City, which is, drag racing was a thing back then, big time. They had the Wrecking Crew playing on their songs, which pretty much you got the Wrecking Crew playing on your song. It's gonna sound incredibly good. You know, they don't make bad songs. They didn't make bad songs. They just knew how to lay down a backing track that just, I mean, if you could sing halfway decent, it's going to sound great. Good thing I didn't run into the Wrecking Crew. I lost my life. I said, good thing I wasn't hanging out in L.A. It's a good thing we lived in Northern California and did not live in L.A. because I would have gotten into showbiz for sure. But it got into definitely and, hooked up with the Wrecking Crew one way or the other. And there goes your life down the drain. Because they gild the lily. Well, that's not quite right. They gild whatever, the gild the, what? The artichoke. They gild the artichoke. I mean, to make it look like a golden artichoke. Our golden artichoke looks great, doesn't it? I never thought of that. Wow, that looks beautiful, golden artichoke. But just a regular old artichoke, it looks kind of spiny. You get the reverb chamber working and everything they had working for them, the mics they had. Oh my gosh, that's why these people who go into showbiz, they lose their minds because the production know-how around these so-called stars is ridiculous. The real geniuses are all the people in the background you never hear about that put all the glitz and glamour and sparkle on everything. And the stars are just, these personalities who people kind of say, I can do that too. Just kind of, like the guy next door, the girl next door. But they're a star. They sound so good. I can sing that way too. So this is part of showbiz, is get these people just kind of seem like, ordinary you and me, and make them sound super great. And then everybody gets pulled into this dream belief that they can sound that good too. So this promotes record sales because I got to get that record. I mean, listen to it. Let me practice. Let me get the new record. Let me get that. This is the secret of it all. This is the secret of the whole music business, entertainment business, the whole business of it. They don't want to get some star who just says, look, folks, you can never sound like me. There's no way in heck. Usually they don't want that. In other cases, like Pavarotti or something, to get somebody. But usually they want to get somebody who says, I'm just like you. Or you can sound like me, no problem. Just buy the instruments, buy the records, just buy all into all this stuff we're selling you. And you're going to sound like me too. And this suckers everybody in. It's a sucker play, entertainment. Yeah, if I, back in the day, if I had all the Wrecking Crew and all this stuff like sound, I could knock it out of the ballpark. Easy. It's ridiculous. Anything. I could just be a singing fool. I could just do record after record after record after record after record. Easy. But they're just using you. until somebody else comes along they want to use. And then if you dropped out of that whole thing, then you start, people start saying, "Hey, you don't sound as good. What happened to you?" "Well, yeah, I'm retired or something." Yeah, if you, you know, life is short-lived, and people realize, wow, you didn't really have that much talent. And then you really have to try. You know, the guy, there's some guys who have really good talent, like Dion. He really has the talent. You know, some people have really good talent. And then you put the glitz on them, they just sound fabulous. Tom Jones, a lot of talent, really. Great singer, Tom Jones. Still got it, you know. Wow, what a set of pipes on him. But still, I mean, they got the orchestra, the whole thing. I mean, the production on the sound is, you know, he's got everything working for him still. He is such a mega star that they, you know, they make sure that what you're hearing is just absolutely tweaked to the max. But he can still sing, that is for sure. So entertainment thing is bad news because they're tricking you. They have this pitch perfect stuff now. These singers now, with you know, they tweak your singing now with digitally. So I mean, you know, you could be, you know, got an artichoke voice and make it sound great. Live they do it too, live. So these artists now, I mean, but it's all the more makes you seem like, wow, that's like some nerdy art guy, you know, in my art class is just some got up and, you know, now he's like the superstar. He's so, wow, if he could do it, I could do it. And so you get hooked into the whole music thing. And the fact is that the more you're willing to sell your soul to this whole scam, the more, you know, you get promoted. So you really got to sell your soul to make it, pretty much so. You got to play this whole act. Really do. You got, and you know you're conning everybody. And really helping ruin their lives, waste their lives, actually. So that's another reason why I play with music and sing lousy. I want to wake people up to this. You know, don't get trapped in music. Don't get trapped in it. It's not super positivity anyway. Sing lousy. You know, the better I sing, the more I shift to the lousy singing just to balance it. Say, hey, helping everyone out with that, because there's one of the worst traps there is entertainment. One of the worst. You get fixated on it for a lifetime, easily. I know lots who are. Fixated on it for a lifetime. Completely waste your life. Waste your opportunity. Think of, that could be me. Oh my God, if I just had that dress. If I just had those shoes. If I just had the makeup artist. Oh my God, I can dance to this music. You know, it just sucks everybody in. I can sing like, I can do this. I'm just the guy next door, is it? You know, wow. No. You get the hot rodders who put the wax job on it, man. And you know, the coral wax job sure looks pretty. Gonna get my chick, get my money, get my chick, and take her out to Drag City. Yeah, you get promoted. You get promoted. You get promoted and promoted and promoted. And boy, you think you're the boss. No, you're just helping them with their shtick. Their scam. Their scheme. It's a dirty business. Entertainment's a very dirty, dirty business. It's even more dirty. I know someone very well who was in both politics and entertainment, big time, at the top. And they say that entertainment's even dirtier than politics. Even dirtier than politics. And politics is extremely dirty. It's the truth. There's nothing dirtier than entertainment. So don't promote it, you know. Yeah, eat your heart out. I'll sing some honky-tonk and then, bleh, you know, stop. Stop. Well, don't stop, man. You sound so great. We can promote you. Oh, stop. Oh, I just stop. I feel like stopping. Take two, you know, come on. Sing it halfway through. Oh, he's just nailing it. He's absolutely nailing it. And then What'd you do? You sang the wrong words. Oh, I just felt like singing different words, you know. Yeah, you can't do that. You know, we got to get a product here. I drive the studio musicians and the producers absolutely nuts. They'd fire me. Record label will fire me. No record label's gonna, so it would sign me. So I'm not gonna do what they tell me to do. Because you're selling these false dreams, you know, of stardom to everybody, which is selling this dream of positivity to everybody as we do what? As we continue watching this dream of death. It's not really a dream. We're dreaming that we're dreaming. I mean, we're not dreaming we're dreaming. We're pretending that we're dreaming. We're pretending we're having a dream in which we're dreaming. That's even, you know, if you look at it, you can look at it even that way, actually. First, you can say, well, we have a dream that we're dreaming. But then you even go back further, that we're pretending to have a dream in which of dreaming. So it really confounds us, you see, the way we've set it up. We're pretending that we're having a dream that we're dreaming. This is a good way of looking at it. Because I might be singing a song and suddenly have this insight, and guess what? The insight wins over the song. Yeah. It does. It does. It does. I mean, I try never to be so hip that when an inside breaks, you can't break that hipness. And say, "Well, I'm going right to this insight right now." It's like breaking news story. We've stopped this. We stopped this song to break into the break. We have a breaking news story here, you know, which we're likely to get pretty soon in this world. There'd likely to be some breaking news story, news coming in. But we won't break for that. But we will break for insights. I break for non-dual insights, or non-dual insights on board. Is that a baby on board? Non-dual insights on board. Be careful. Here's someone with non-dual insights on board. I gotta make sure I drive carefully. Drive like non-dual insights lived here. In your little suburban street. I break for non-dual insights. I do. Say that. Get Cafe Press to give that one for you. I break for non-dual insights. Some entrepreneurs just saying, "Oh my God, I just got a gold mine." You know, well, actually, most people don't get it, so I don't think it's gonna be a gold mine. Don't worry about making a gold mine. Just listen to Coach Longchenpa. Just listen to Coach Longchenpa. Let him coach you up. He'll tell you what to do. How we doing here? 201. 201, and is it getting late? Who cares? Oh, I gotta hit that kale smoothie tonight. It's a lot of work straining the doggone thing, you know, because all the pulp gets in the strainer liquid starts going through. So you gotta use a spoon and smash the pulp against the mesh and kind of push the, you know, express the juice through the pulp. But it takes quite a while to do that. I don't know any better way. That pulp's gotta go, you know. I don't know what you could do with it. You could make pulp tablets out of it, I guess. Sell them as kale pulp tablets. It's like the newest thing. It's like better than whey. Kale pulp tablets. We extract the pulp from the juicing of kale. It's got all this incredible chlorophyllic fiber. It's like the healthiest thing for you ever. I tell you what, in this world, you can't get people to pray for other people, can you? But if you got a sick dog, you can get everybody to pray for that sick dog, can't you? But who's going to pray for people? Isn't that something? Isn't that something? Just wow it. As much as apropos of nothing. It's like, yeah. Wow. They'll be doing masses for dogs pretty soon. This mass is for Barky, you know, who's suffering from this, you know, some illness here. And we sure all hope that Barky gets well. And raise your hands for Barky. You know. Oh, yeah, of course. Because people say, well, why not? We're all animals, right? So why don't we celebrate mass for the animals, too? Come on. We're all animals, really? 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 I didn't know that. I thought we were just pretending to be asleep, dreaming a dream of being human animals. I thought that was it. In fact, it is it. Oh yeah, it is it. Right. I never fell asleep, did I? I never started dreaming. Nobody has. That's right. Thank you, Longchenpa. All praise. 1,000 shimmering lotus petals of light praise, of living light praise to the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa, who by just walking past us infects us with the incurable virus of superconfidence. Yep, it's incurable. Nothing I can do, folks. I've got this incurable life sentence, you know. Where I got this incurable eternal life sentence. It's going to end up in eternal life. You know, nothing anyone can do about it. It's completely incurable. Oh. Yeah. People ask me, what's wrong with you? Well, I got this incurable disease. You know, what is that? Super confidence. Huh? Yeah. Yeah, it leads to eternal life. Yeah, it's nothing I can do about it. Oh, wow. Sorry to hear that. What a pity. You know, it's like, it's awful. Oh, my gosh. Well, I'll pray for you. And I said, wow, you know, even prayers don't help this out. Well, I don't know. My God can do mighty things and might even be able to cure this super confidence you have so you won't end up with eternal life. You know, it's just terrible. It's such a fate. I'll pray for you anyway. I'll give out, you know. I'll pray for you. Oh, yeah, get the sob sisters praying for you. I'll do a rosary for you. It's just awful. You can't get the positivity. You can't never get to death. You can't taste death. That's just so awful. I'm going to do a rosary for you nonstop. I'll do a novena for you. Doomed to eternal life. How terrible. 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 Poor thing, you. Must be something we can do. I feel so terrible for you. Yeah. That's how they do it. And then gradually you feel so... Oh, God. I feel so bad. So they start thinking, what can I do? You know, maybe I can cure this somehow. Yeah, maybe I'll pretend that I'm dead, you know, watching this death movie. Maybe I'll pretend something. Maybe I'll pretend I feel awful. You know, maybe I am dying, you know. I feel it, you know. Yeah, I really feel like death. Don't worry, don't cry, don't cry. Yeah, this is what happens here. It's exactly what happens here. You don't want to hurt those sob sisters. Feel so bad for you. Ruined their mascara. Look, they're mad, pretty mad. Their mascara's run has ruined their pretty face. It's awful. You don't want to do that. Cause their mascara to run like that. I just feel terrible. But I don't feel that terrible. I mean, maybe next life I'll feel terrible, but not right now. Cause like I gotta cheerleader. You can't have a cheerleader feeling terrible now. Come on. That's asking too much right here. All you're missing out is just one little old death. You know, what's the big deal? you can have as many deaths as you want. If you want to really dabble in it, you know. So, you know, hey, maybe later I'll watch the movie with you, the death movie with you, but not this time, right? Not right now. Somebody's calling me out of my seat. I hear my Lord calling, you know. I hear a voice calling. It's calling. Well, it's Longchenpa's call. Hey, come on. You know, I'm ready to coach here. Let's start. Let's pump up the volume here on the sidelines. Yeah, you hear the coach calling. You can't dismiss that. Come on. I make my coach unhappy, do you? I want to make him all sad-faced. I mean, he's got such a happy face. Why should I make him sad-faced? That's even terrible than seeing the mascara running down your pretty cheeks. I don't want to mess up Longchenpa's face. I mean, it's even worse. Come on. Have a heart. I couldn't bear to see Longchenpa cry, could you? No. That just would not fit at all. So have some heart. Cut me a little break here, you know. You know, take a slight little break from death. You know, you've been doing it so long. You've been doing it in the future. You can handle a little tea break, tea and crumpets for you. It's only 10 o'clock. Wow. That's nice. We're taking our death break right now. Having our biscuits. Crumpets and biscuits. And I don't know. In the tea room. Yeah, nice little tea room. Everybody's... We used to have all these tea rooms in the Silicon Valley. I don't know where they are now. That was like the big thing. Everybody was going to tea. I mean, it's hilarious, this place. You know, all the gold diggers, they got to get their culture on, you know. They come from the sticks, you know, and hook some tech nerd, and they I'm a lady now. I've got to learn how to take tea lessons. They're all looking around like, you don't see that I work a gold digger, do you? No, I'm drinking the right wine. Come on. I took lessons. Everybody takes lessons here in culture. Because, they're nerds and they're gold diggers. That's it. They don't have any culture. What's their culture? Vanity or something. I don't know. there's nothing wrong with the nerds and the cold diggers. They're wonderful. I saw this techie. He was pasty and so flabby and out of show. Oh my God! And he's starting this, you know, cross training program or something. It's a gym thing where he's just, you know, they do all this cross training stuff, and he's trying to jog. He's like, what the heck am I doing? He's like, oh my gosh, he looked like Brian Wilson after 3 years in bed or something, you know. But, you know, God bless him. He's, you know, he's trying to move it. But he's got a pretty flabby behind there, you know. Just woo, 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 woo. But he's giving it a good try because, you know, he's got to look like he's got to... The gold diggers just telling him, hey, look, you know, I'm really ripped, you know. And so... Maybe if you start getting with it, people will think like we're like really hip. You got to look better, man. And they start dictating to the nerds. Come on, how are we gonna get in higher society if you aren't looking a little better? You know, get out there and get cross trained. And the guy's just like saying, "What the heck is this? What did she talk me into now?" He said, I want to get back to my Twinkies. Are you kidding me? I just want to code and twink out. Twinkie dip it in the espresso. What is better than that? Back in the day, if you got too tired, you know, you need a little boost, you do some lines. Come on. The Twinkies and espresso didn't work. Do the lines. And, you know, that really powers the code. Speaking of, what's the worst drug in the world? Caffeine is the worst drug in the world by far. I realize that we're getting bullied by caffeine. People are caffeine bullies. There's no doubt about it. It's subtle, but it's everywhere. And you can feel it here. I mean, you get bullied all the time here, subtly. And these people are heavily on caffeine. Caffeine turns you into a bully. It really does. Even I turned into a bully on caffeine. It's terrible. It's terrible. Because I've got this super positivity, and you mix that with caffeine, and I get, you know, a little over the edge. But you still, it's so creative, but it's still, I recognize, hey, you know, that's a little too strong. Well, you could come on really strong. You better not be on any stimulants at all, because that warps your judgment. You have to have good judgment, really good judgment. And you got to have compassion. You got to speak from compassion. And when the caffeine starts speaking for you, you know, compassion goes out the window. And you start making people look bad. And you bully them. Caffeine's a bully. It's a bully drug. It turns people into bullies. That's why there's so much bullying going on. It's the caffeine. It's the caffeine. It's also a severe aphrodisiac. Because, you know, it gives you false confidence, you bully, and all this kind of stuff. It's a nasty, nasty drug. It's the worst drug in the world. Should be outlawed, actually. That's right. Starbucks caffeine should be outlawed. So, what you could go to selling kelp smoothies. Come on. It's better for people anyway. Hey, you diversify. Howard, come on, diversify. You're already diversifying. Just diversify more. Right? Go to decaf for a while, and even that's got some bullying capabilities, and then go to your kale smoothies. Be great for everybody. Yeah, the best you could do in the world is just shut down caffeine, actually, right now. Caffeine is the major disruptor of spiritual culture in the world right now. The major number one culprit. Nothing even comes close. Nicotine is not nearly the problem. Caffeine is not nearly the problem, spiritually speaking. Not at all. Not at all. Nicotine doesn't turn you into a bully. It doesn't. It doesn't. It's different. It's different. Of course, they singled out nicotine. You know, they're the bad guys for everything. But caffeine, nobody says anything about caffeine. Well, hardly. Well, you know, moderation, don't take too much. But no, it's just perfectly great. I get in the morning, I start caffeine. I had a friend tell me, he says, I'm addicted to it. I started to stop. I got the severe headache. You know, he told me how he started out. He says, wow, it's not good for me. But I can't stop. It's extremely addictive. How many people have stopped drinking coffee? Almost nobody. Or caffeine. Once you start, you keep shifting different, you know, products and stuff. You think, oh, but how many people, you know, I'm drinking black tea now, everything's fine, or green tea, you know. No, you're still a caffeine addict. The number one addiction in the world is caffeine. Nothing comes close to that. And it makes you a spiritual bully. It absolutely does. It gives you overconfidence in positivity, which turns you into a real, you know, bully. Because you try to bring the super positive, you can't do it. So you try to bully with the positivity. And that, you know, that's bad. It's bad. It's really bad. If you're going to bring it, you got to bring it with super positivity. And you can't be on stimulants when you do that. You cannot. Cannot be on drugs. Absolutely cannot. You won't be able to bring it. You can't be a cheerleader for Longchenpa if you're on stimulants. I guarantee you this. You know, I'm as clean as a whistle. Clean as a whistle. The last thing I did was I started to backslide. I got this chocolate. It's espresso chocolate. It has coffee beans in it or something. I said, wow, that's really good. It's really cheap. I said, let me try this because I was so tired. I was getting so tired driving. I need something to keep me awake. It worked. But subtly, I started saying, wanting more of it. I said, whoa. I knocked it off. I just realized, got to stop. This is a trick. Because they put it in everything. Oh, it's in chocolate. It's fine. It smooths it out. I mean, it's different. It's a different experience. But no, it gets into you subtly. It gets into you subtly. They try to put it in everything now. Everything they possibly can. Include giving it to you free in hospitals. Like they're doing here. 28 Starbucks coffee machines in the hospital. And the doctors and nurses are telling me we're all caffeine addicts now. And then they're not joking either. Actually, the guy that services them all said, look, everybody's a caffeine addict in this hospital. And I said, wait, come on. He said, no. I'm serious. I'm not joking at all. I'm the one who restocks everything. And I talked to him. Believe me, they've just gone nuts. They're addicts now. And I kept saying, are you serious? And he says, I'm absolutely serious. So you got a bunch of caffeine addict doctors operate on you. And I just talked to another guy, two botched operations at this hospital. And in my family, they botched the operation, almost killed them. Very close to it. Bunch of caffeine addicts there. And you lose your compassion when you're on caffeine. You get out of touch with compassion. It's an insidious drug. The most insidious drug probably there is. It's horrible. Because society completely condones it. And actually they joke about it. And they, you know, everybody promotes it. Promoting caffeine is insane. Our priest promotes it. One of them. Yeah, I got up every morning. I have caffeine. I don't know when you have your coffee, he says. But I have mine first thing when I get up. That's horrible. That's horrible to do that. They don't realize the disaster of caffeine. It's a global disaster. Much of the world's problems actually have arisen out of caffeine, because almost everybody, I think it was like 95% of people, drink some sort of caffeine every day, so in some form. You lose your compassion. You get out of touch with compassion. And there's nothing more dangerous than that. So I'm telling you that the troubles are in this world. If we knocked out caffeine from the world today, you would find these are troubles, most of them evaporating. A lot of them evaporating, and you would find a spiritual culture arising in this world, because we'd get back in touch with our compassion. Everybody would. You just can't feel it properly when you're using caffeine. You cannot. You cannot. And you become a bully. You really do. And the fine line that you need, especially if you're a cheerleader for super positivity, super confidence, it's a fine line, and you have to feel the fine line. And you can be super adamant and tough, and that's okay, but you're never out of touch with compassion. You know, if you've got to draw a line, you draw a line. That's okay, but you're not out of touch with compassion at all. And you know it, and you know it. But wow, would you put caffeine in there? No way. You start crossing the line, and you just, the wheels start coming off. And before you know it, you say, I can't handle this gig. And now you're back into positivity and trying to pile that as high as possible, pile higher and deeper. And then you're really in trouble. Then you start being a cultural bully. The world is full of cultural bullies now. The world is full of bullies, caffeine bullies. We're all being harassed by caffeine bullies, and nobody seems to raise a voice except I do here, because that's my job. I'm a cheerleader. I'm a cheerleader for Longchenpa, for Coach Longchenpa. I'm one of his cheerleaders. Okay. So I'm telling it like it is, like Howard Costello would say. I'm telling it like it is, but he only told it a little bit like it is. He was very shrewd, you know, just enough to get people to, hey, is he gonna, what else, what's he gonna say next? But now he understood what the corporate line was, except that he got, when he's gotten his dotage, you know, they kind of had to like phase him out, because he started telling it like it is too much. And they start blathering on, and you know, just, but for a while, you got people saying, well, maybe you got someone's telling it like it is here. But I mean, who tells it like it is in this world anymore? I mean, you got to go to a cheerleader, a Longchenpa cheerleader, to find it. It's ridiculous. The world is so out of touch with compassion. It's ridiculous. But the Dalai Lama says drugs are poison. What do you mean drug? What do you mean legalize? What are you talking about? He said, what are you talking about? Are you crazy? Drugs are poison for the spiritual path. And Dalai Lama understands the spiritual path is based on compassion, real compassion. And drugs get you out of touch with compassion. You might think you're getting more compassion. No, you're not. You might be drinking, so I'm so much more compassion. No, you're not. You're just an idiot. You know, you don't know, understand. Real compassion is tough. It's tough-minded. Draws the line. Dalai Lama said, look, drugs are poison. And they try to basically say, what about, you know, all the stuff the kids are into? Isn't that okay? Dalai Lama says, no, it's not okay. I mean, I respect him so much for that. He takes politically incorrect positions on so much stuff. He doesn't cater, doesn't bend his, what he says, to cater to the youth, at least on some occasions that I'm aware of certain things like that. I don't know, you know, across the board how it is with him, but I certainly know that, and what I've heard from him say about a lot of stuff, he says, no, that's not okay. In fact, it's extremely wrong. And you're not going to make it on the spiritual path if you get into that. That this is a disaster for you. Wow. To have that voice speaking up is so nice. It's so wonderful. But, you know, he's savvy, so savvy that he doesn't try to alienate people. He kind of, you know, tries to present it in a jolly, unalienated way. But for me, you know, we got to be pretty punchy right here, right now. We got this contest going on for your attention in terms of something that is very, very crucial. And you got to see what we stand for. You know, at some point, you got to have a come to Jesus moment. And you got to realize, wow. You have a wow moment that just stops you in your tracks and experience the wow. Heavy, 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 strong wow. It's like anything else. If you go down a road too far with a too bad of a vice, and we don't, it's insidious, this world. Everything's compounding. And you got this caffeinated world right now. It's out of touch with compassion, thinking that they're saving everybody by work. When they're out of touch with compassion, don't even know what salvation is at all. This is a disaster for the world. So you get this situation going on. And you get bullied so bad, and you get people said, whoa. This is really serious situation we're in. Way more than I realized. They're going to want somebody who's adamant. You know? When you get kids like being tempted by drugs so terribly by our culture, you know, they're going to say, well, wait a minute, this could really mess up my life. You want the Dalai Lama saying drugs are poison. You want to say, thank you, God bless, and thank you very much. And I'm going to say, you know, the Dalai Lama says stay away, drugs are poison, so I'm going to stay away from him because, you know, he's a spiritual authority. I respect him. I hope young people are hip to this. I mean, if young people want to be hip, then why don't they be hip to something that is truly authoritative? I mean, how could you say you're hip if you're not aware of what's really truly authoritative? The whole idea of hipness is that you're aware of a higher authority than most people. Otherwise, well, what is hip? It means you're stupid. Nobody wants to be stupid. So the whole thing of hipness is you're really aware of what's really going on, where the real authority is coming from. But too many of the idiots, they go to the drug pushers. The drug pushers know they're really hip. They've done all these chemical studies. They found this drug's really good for you, you know, or something. And they think that that's being hip. No, that's just being uber stupid. Go to the real authorities. You know, be really hip. And when Longchenpa walks past you and hails you, you're really hip. That's hipness. You just say, wow. Very humbling. When Coach Chempa, you know, the Coach Longchenpa passes you by, wow. I just got infected with this incurable bug of super confidence. That's what's hip. And don't do the reverse hipness, that being unhip is hip. You know, that is so stupid, because the whole idea of being hip is you're aware of the real story, the real truth, the real authority, what the best stuff really is. You know, like, I'm hip to this, you know, new product, this product, wow, this is really healthy for you, right? So your idea is that you're hip to what's really healthy for you. That's the whole idea. The hippies were hip to what's really healthy for you, at least they thought they were. This was the whole hippie movement. I mean, to that extent, I was aware of it, certainly. And listen, I mean, sure, you want to be aware of what's really healthy for you, right? So the hippies said, I know what's really healthy for you, except they didn't in a lot of ways. Not really. Some hippies were pretty hip. The good hippies were pretty hip. And we thank them for that. Because they say, I know about Sri Sri Anandamayi, you know, come on. That's really super hip. A few of them did. And I know this guru, you know, that I know that they're saying this is really good for you. You know, I mean, I'm hip to the fact that, you know, cigarettes aren't good for you. I'm hip to the fact that, you know, this caffeine got to knock this stuff. So thank you, hippies, for being hip to that stuff, because it was helpful. You know, I'm hip to this is what the healthy lifestyle should be. So the hippies did a lot of good, but a lot of them got contaminated, and they did what they could do, but they passed the baton off, you know, to others who, you know, could run the next leg of the race. And now we're running the final, you know, final leg of the relay race. And so, you know, you put your best sprinter in the final leg of the relay race. So here I am, you know, got the baton now, and I can really sprint. And, you know, that's you get trained to be a real sprinter. So run the final leg here, you can make up a lot of ground. Get Carl Lewis running the final leg of the, you know, the 220 relay or something. Man, that was something to watch. I'm telling you. Yeah, you know, he's behind, man. He says, man, hey, here I come. I'm eating up the yards here, man. I'm just lengthening my stride. And I'm going to get you at the finish line for sure. There's no doubt about it. Carl Lewis has got the baton. He's gonna get him at the finish line. Who do we got? Who do we got now? Usain Bolt. have Bolt run the final leg of a relay. I mean, holy cow. That's pretty exciting. So we're in the final leg of this relay race now, and you know, here come the top dog sprinters in this. And yeah, you gotta let it go. It's all out sprint right now. And again, Coach Longchenpa's in the house. Count on it. Believe in it. Call on him. I say, Coach, great to see you. Really, seriously, hail him. I say, Coach Longchenpa, thanks for being here. You know, seriously, before you go to bed, to say, you know, I'm determined. I'm going to make a connection with Coach Longchenpa. Just tell him, man, I'm so glad you're here, man. All blessings and grace and success to you. I'm just thrilled you're here. I'm absolutely thrilled you're here, Coach. Go get him. So like you're part of the audience, just you say, hey, Coach Longchenpa, thanks for being here. I'm just so thrilled you're here. And he'll, you know, turn around and wave to you. Absolutely. He'll smile and give a thumbs up. Hey, you know, yeah. Seriously, hail him.